It came to mind this week, today, and the many weeks after sitting with parents and listening to parents about the challenges that their young children talk about. It came to me today that it's very, very important that a message should be delivered with regards to how we as parents need to ensure that we need to protect our children, or we need to protect, you know, our young brothers and sisters out there. The reason being is because what's very astonishing is that how now a two-year-old child can use a phone and can navigate through a phone. And then one person thinks that if this child at the age of two is doing this, what powers and what ability will that child have at the age of 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10? And it seems as though the world has developed to an extent where now the trials and tribulations for youngsters and children have only increased and increased and increased and increased. And that's why our duty as parents and as elders and as brothers and as senior siblings is to make sure that we ensure that our children have the best environment. The best environment. And that's why what I want to talk about today is that oftentimes we think about how the environment outside affects our children. You know, I've met many people who said to me that, you know, I had a son, he memorized 15, you know, Siparas, 15 juz of the Holy Quran. He memorized half of the Holy Quran, but he came to Canada and because of the environment, he forgot everything. But was that forgetting everything because of the environment? And that's why, like I discussed last week, is we cannot play the blame game. And that also means not blaming the environment. Because we talked about how last week, we need to refrain from blaming other people for our mistakes. That is not a good, pure, and honest, and sincere presidency whatsoever. In fact, the reality is, if we want to be sincere, we have to admit our mistakes, because if we can't admit our mistakes, how will we learn from our mistakes? And that's why when many times that I hear from elders and from many people saying, oh, the environment changed him, and you know, society changed him, and you know, coming to Canada changed him, living in the West changed, all these kind of things, honestly, it doesn't really make sense, to be honest with you. Yes, the environment, a different environment, can have some sort of effect on you. But the most important and the most impactful environment that exists is the environment of the home. The environment of the home is the most impactful environment whatsoever. It doesn't matter where you live, whether you live in the Fiji Islands, whether you live in Karachi, Lahore, whether you live in Toronto, Germany, Berlin, London. What matters is the environment of the home. And that's why, when, as a father, if I want my child to memorize the Holy Quran, or if I want my child to read the Quran for 2 hours a day, the question is, how is my own relationship with the Quran? How much time do I devote myself with the Book of Allah Ta'ala? How much do I yearn to seek knowledge? How much time do I spend reading about the religion of Islam? How much time do I spend listening to the Quran? If I'm listening to Drake, how can I expect my son to listen to Qari Abdul Basit? Doesn't make sense, does it? So what it comes down to is, my brothers and sisters, is yes, society does have an impact, but it's a minor impact. The major impact is from the home. And the major impact is from the company that the child, and the nourishment that the child receives, and that is from the parents. And that is from the elder siblings. And it's not just parents who influence children, it's elder siblings. I have seen families being destroyed because of one elder sibling who destroyed all his brothers. Why? Because he made them indulge in evil, because he himself was indulging in evil. And I know we have this concept traditionally, especially those who come from the Indo-Pakistan continent, that the elder brother is the most important and we have to follow the elder brother, and the elder brother always has to be consulted. But if the elder brother is a jahil, he's wrong, then he doesn't have to be obeyed. So my brothers and sisters, what we need to understand is, if we really want to protect our children and our youth, is we as parents, we cannot be hypocrites. We cannot be liars, we cannot be cheaters and deceivers and backbiters and people who just point fingers and look down at other people and who think we are better than everyone else. We can't have this attitude, because this attitude will then be passed down to our children. And I see that day in and day out. Honestly, teaching young children, I see parents in young children. I see the same, in young children I see their parents. And many times we look towards the reasons for why is someone not advancing? Why is someone not doing well? Why is someone not changing? And then one just needs to reflect on those who are the leaders of this child, yani the parents, and then one realizes that the mentoring that this child is receiving is not the correct mentorship, is not the correct leadership. And that's why as parents we have a huge role. We have, as parents, as grandparents, as elder brothers, as elder sisters, as mothers, we have a pivotal role to play in society. We can't blame the mosque, we can't blame the imam, we can't blame the Quran teacher. We have to take the blame. We have to learn how we are responsible for, I am responsible for my children. If my children are going to learn how to swear, it's going to be from me. It's going to be from my home. Whatever is going to be cooked in my home, that is what's going to affect my children. Because whatever they eat from my home, that's what's going to come out. And that's why if in the home they are given this spirituality, if they are given good akhlaq, if they are given good values and good traditional values and good Islamic values, then the children will imbibe from them and take from them, and with that they will not just help themselves, but they will help the world. And that's what we need to do, my brothers and sisters. And that's why it's so important to bring our children to the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's so important to bring our children to the masajid, to the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's extremely important. Whether it's bringing them for salah, fajr, asr, maghrib, any salah, anytime you can bring them. Whether it's bringing them in the masjid just to teach them something, or just to read the Quran with them, or whether it's bringing them so that they can learn the Quran. But you see, what really impacts children is when you bring them to the masjid, when you bring them to the house of Allah Ta'ala, but you also spend some time in the house of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. You see parents, you see children, they always wonder where their parents are. They love their parents. They always want to know where their parents are. Now, when as fathers and mothers, we give children some time, when they also see us now involved in the mosque of Allah Ta'ala, doing khidmah of the mosque of Allah Ta'ala, reading the Quran, then the children, they get motivated, they get inspired to excel and to advance. So that's why, my brothers and sisters, what I want to point out today is that this concept where we say, society changed our children, maybe we made a wrong decision, maybe we should have stayed in Pakistan and India. But let me tell you one thing, my brothers and sisters, the deen, Alhamdulillah, in my opinion, is more valued in the West as opposed to places like Pakistan. And you'd say to me, what am I saying? It's because I'm telling you something that I a couple of days ago, I went to the house of one of my friends who is a physician, and his child, who he homeschools, by the way, at the age of 11, this child memorizes 21 pages of the Holy Quran. An 11-year-old memorizes 21 pages of the Holy Quran every week. To the extent where he has done 15 parts of the Holy Quran, and he has a self-target that he's going to finish the Holy Quran next August. This is an 11-year-old Canadian child. But you know what made this child, in my opinion, a wali and a saint and a leader and a future scholar and a future leader of Islam in this country? What made him this to this level, what made him this wonderful being and this wonderful spiritual and saint of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is his the tarbiyah of his parents. Because that same child, he's no different from his parents. His same father spends any time that he gets studying the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, giving charity for the religion of Islam, helping people. Yani, the point I'm trying to make, brothers and sisters, is we have to lead by example. This is what presidency is all about. Leading by example. If we want our children to become leaders, if you want them to become the leaders, you know, in various types of fields, whether it's Islam, whether it's law, medicine, whatever it may be, we have to show them leadership from coming from ourselves. And we have to instill leadership values in them, like this father instilled this value in this child. And that's why we have to understand, my brothers and sisters, we can't blame society, we can't blame other people when we are negligent towards our children. Because this is nothing but ignorance, my brothers and sisters. We have to evaluate today, my brothers and sisters, not tomorrow, but yesterday, but today, since we have today, and Allah Ta'ala, you know, we thank Allah Ta'ala for today. We thank Allah Ta'ala for giving us health, for giving us wealth. But we have to today, my brothers and sisters, evaluate the tarbiyah, the upbringing that we have given to our children, and what we need, how we need to change that. We have to evaluate ourselves today. We need to look at our children, and we need to look within ourselves, and we need to see, and we need to realize that, what do I actually want from my children? And what we really want from our children, my brothers and sisters, at the end of the day, is for them to be good human beings, for them to be lovers of Allah and His Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and for them to be steadfast on the religion of Islam. Everything else is secondary, my brothers and sisters, because you see, faith matters the most. Faith, iman, is the most important thing. Iman, faith, is the most important thing. And subhanAllah, when I see, you know, this young child, an 11-year-old, subhanAllah, who is spending his time memorizing the Holy Quran, who is in love with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who spends his nights sending salawat on the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, it gives me real hope that inshallah, very soon in Canada, we are going to have scholars who are going to be people who change lives. But the point is, it also makes us realize as that we have special children in our communities. We have leaders, we have saints. At the same time, we have wonderful parents out there who really inculcate the right priorities in the children. And we need to be like those parents, my brothers and sisters. And we have to support our children. We have to support our children in a way that we allow them to do what they love to do. If a child wants to become an artist, we should give them that motivation. We should give them the choice, in a sense, to do what they like to do. Because Islam, my brothers and sisters, is a religion of It's a religion of compassion. It's a religion of rahmah. It's a religion of rahmah. And that's why as parents, we need to have rahmah on our children. And having rahmah on our children also means having rahmah towards our children, towards our younger brothers, is that we also need to ensure that we work towards, you know, educating them and, you know, providing the best opportunities for them. This is very, very important, my brothers and sisters. And that's why we need to learn from this example. This example is from, it's from the GTA, it's not from another country. And what that also goes to say is that, yes, society has many challenges. There's lots of fitna out there. There's various different challenges. But that being said, my brothers and sisters, we all have the potential, my brothers and sisters. We all have the potential. We just need that will to change. And to change and to divert our navigation from falsehood to the haqq. And we need to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not tomorrow, but today. Today we have to turn to Allah ta'ala and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because tomorrow may never come. Tomorrow may never come, and today is an opportunity given to us by Allah ta'ala. And today is the day where we have to work towards changing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is latif. He is gentle. He's Rahman, He's Ar-Rahim, He's the most compassionate. Allah Ta'ala will give us time. But we don't know how much of that time we have. But we need to make that journey to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. And that's why, my brothers and sisters, let me reiterate and come back to the point where let's not blame society. Let's not blame society for the problems in our home. Let's not blame society for the problems that I have within myself. Let me not blame society for the evil traits outside. But in fact, what I need to do is I need to look into my own self. I need to look into the mirror. And I need to analyze myself. And I need to myself work on my flaws, because I have so many of my own flaws to worry about, let alone worrying about everyone else's problems and everyone else's weaknesses and everyone else's mistakes. I need to correct my mistakes. But before understanding the importance and realizing how I need to correct my mistakes, I need to admit my weaknesses and my mistakes. Because there is no way to elevation, there's no way to success without understanding one's mistakes, without admitting one's mistake. That is the beginning, my brothers and sisters, and we have to embark on that beginning, that the journey of the beginning of self-reflection, self-realization. This is what Islam is all about. This is why we have five prayers. We have Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha. These prayers are scattered around the day. Why? Because every single prayer is a means of reflection for us. Every single prayer ought to navigate us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who do we think we are? We have no power whatsoever. We have no power whatsoever. But when we journey with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have all the powers. But when we are living the world without a conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, without a spiritual connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we have no power. We have no power, there's no success, there's nothing but failure. And that's why, my brothers and sisters, it starts from ourselves, from myself. And it has to start today, my brothers and sisters. There has to be a change. You know, we have to, every single day, even if it's for half an hour, get a pen and a paper and look and analyze and say, you know what, I get angry very quickly. I need to work on my anger. Maybe I'm rude to people. So I need to make sure that I'm nice to people, because I want people to be nice to me. Number three, for example, I'm talking about my own flaws, by the way. I'm not talking about anyone else's flaws. Number three, I need to be more generous. Number four, I need to spend more time with my parents. Number five, I need to spend more time with my wife, with my children. Number six, I need to give my children time. I need to teach them about the Holy Quran. I need to teach them about the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Number seven, I need to learn how to listen to others. Number eight, I need to learn how to respect others. Number nine, I need to spend more time in the masjid. number 10, I need to pray on time punctually. I need to work on praying in Jama'ah, in congregation. I mean, the list will go on and on and on and on. But slowly but surely, there's 30 days in a week. If every single day we improve and we work on one weakness, imagine after a month how strong we can be. This is what we need to do, my brothers and sisters. I mean, if you think you're perfect, then go. Leave now, go. Think you're perfect? Why do you think we come every week? It's because we are not perfect. We're imperfect. And we come to cleanse ourselves. But most importantly, we come to remind ourselves about how needy we are of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what we need, my brothers and sisters. When are we going to improve? When are we going to improve our akhlaq? Because akhlaq is everything. The religion is all about akhlaq. And you see, until we don't improve all our weaknesses, how can we help our community? How can I help my family? How can I help society? How can I help my brothers and sisters? How can I talk to people when I'm not even focused on improving myself? A leader is someone, and we're all leaders here, by the way. Every single one sitting here is a leader. You're an elder brother, you're an elder son, you're a businessman, you're a doctor, you're an engineer, you're a senior employment, you're a senior in your corporation, in your workplace. Everyone is a leader in any capacity. But a true leader is someone who improves, who improvises daily, who wants to improve, and who works towards improving. And as parents and as leaders, we need to work towards that. It's very important. And also what's very important is always standing corrected. To always stand corrected. That we do things and we give our ideas and we give our thoughts. But when someone comes with more knowledge, with more wisdom, with more guidance, we stand corrected, because part of leadership also is listening and listening to the advice of others. That's very important, my brothers and sisters. You know, my brothers and sisters, the reason why I'm saying all these things is because it's 2016. It's 2016 and families are broke. Not broke financially, families are broken. The relationship amongst the brothers is not there anymore. There's no communication, there's enmity, there's jealousy. You know, families can't stand one another. You know, marriages are being ruined daily. You know, the divorce rate, how high is it? You can tell me. Why? Because simple reasons. Because of the lack of compassion. Because of the lack of maturity. Because of the lack of sincere love. Because of the lack of controlling anger. All these problems. Another issue we have, my brothers and sisters, is the miscommunication and the distance between young children and parents. There's a whole distance. The parents are watching their drama, and the son is listening to his, what he wants to listen to. He's watching whatever he wants. I mean, there's no bonding. Who's gonna do the bonding? You know, we ask ourselves, what happened to my children? Well, if I did not bond with my children, then they probably went and bonded with someone. So we ought to blame, my brothers and sisters. We can't blame society, you know. And yes, you know, we always like to blame the friends of our children, and yes, friends have an influence, but the question is, who are my friends? And that's why I'm going to tell you something now, and I'm going to conclude very in the next minute or so, is, remember I told you about this 11-year-old child from Canada, son of a physician. He memorizes 21 pages of the Holy Quran, self-motivated, probably the most highly respectful children I've met, and honestly, probably the most, without any exaggeration, probably the biggest saint I've met. And from 11 years old, I've seen him, and I haven't seen a saint bigger than him in Canada. Maybe I'm wrong, but this is my opinion, you know. Yani someone who's seen the Prophet Sallallahu Ta'ala Alaihi Wa Alaihi Wasallam at the age of 11, yes. This is something, you know. And someone who, you know, who reads on a Thursday night, who spends the whole night reading salawat on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But you know why? You know how he got there? How did this child become like this? I'll tell you how he became like this. Obviously the tarbiyah of his father, but it's also because his father had the right friendship. The father had the friendship of Ahlullah. The father would take his child in the midst, in the presence of Ahlullah, in the presence of the saints of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His father would ask the Ahlullah, the people of Allah, Oh Mashaykh, Sheikh, please pray for my child. Please, make dua for my child. His father would serve the people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, would save the ulama of haq, would serve them, would help them. And that's why now he has a child who's from Ahlullah, because Ahlullah prayed for this child to become from Ahlullah. The point is, my brothers and sisters, we have to surround ourselves with Ahlullah, with the people of Allah. And how many of us do that? It's because, my brothers and sisters, in society, we blame society, but we are victims of society. When it comes to making friends in society, we want to make friends with the people who have high status, big name. Because then, you know, if we become friends with them, you know, we'll become famous, we'll be known. You know, become friends with a physician, you know, you'll get respect. Become friends with various professionals. Oh, I know an accountant, I know a lawyer. That means I know all these people, so I'm something, you know, I'm myself something, I have all these friends, but everyone is good, my brothers and sisters. But the point I'm trying to say is, my brothers and sisters, if we want our children to be influenced in the right way, my brothers and sisters, we need to take them to the people of Allah Ta'ala. But taking them means we going there ourselves. How many of us spend time? How many, whenever a wali of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala comes to Canada, how many of us actually have the basic courtesy to go visit him? To sit in his majlis, to sit with adab, to say, Shaykh, please advise me. Rather, what I notice is sometimes when we have mashayikh come and big awliya come, we have people who want to advise them and want to talk about this and that with them, and then you look around and you say, then you realize that, you know, this is the problem. But the point I'm trying to make, my brothers and sisters, is if we want to ensure that our children have the right sohbah, we as parents need to make sure we have the right sohbah. You know, meet your local imam. As parents, come, get to know your local imam, sit with them, talk to them, get advice from them, get du'as from them, my brothers and sisters. Get du'as from them, my brothers and sisters. You know, these du'as of these people who spend every single day reading Fajr, reading Dhuhr, reading Asr, Maghrib, Isha. They spend their time in the Book of Allah, reading and teaching the Book of Allah. They spend their time helping people selflessly. They don't make people sign retainers. They go to someone's house to make dua for him. They go to the hospital when someone dies. They go to the graveyard. These people are selfless. Spend time with them. Take your children to them and ask them to make dua for your children, my brothers and sisters. Then, only then will success will come. Only then will our children be protected. But the more we as elders, we distance ourselves from the ulama, the more we distance ourselves from Ahlullah, because we're not interested in meeting Ahlullah. Why? Just because of one bad experience? Just because I had a bad experience with a lawyer, just for example, does that mean I hate all lawyers and I don't seek legal advice? If I don't seek legal advice, I'm not gonna be protected. Likewise, yes, there's good and bad everywhere, but we have to look, because there are righteous ulama, there are righteous imams, you know, the imams of this mosque, you know, the imams around everywhere. Look, counsel them, sit with them, and take du'as from them, my brothers and sisters. Befriend them, because they don't need your friendship, or we need their friendship. We need their guidance, because it's from their spiritual guidance that we can change ourselves. It's through their du'as that we can become something. And if I'm standing here today at the age of 47, born in the UK, having gone through high school, through college, through university, having seen everything what any average young individual has seen, if I am standing and speaking to you here today, if I've memorized the Quran, if I have studied Islamic, history and seerah and Islamic studies and Dars-e Nizami, it's not because of me, it's not because I'm something. But it's because my father, at a young age, he put me in the presence of Ahlullah. And through the words and through the du'as of Ahlullah, I'm standing in front of you today. I'm being very, very honest and bold with you, my brothers and sisters. We don't have much opportunities, but never let an opportunity pass by. When you have the opportunity to sit with someone who is close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we rather sit with someone who's distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's very, very important, my brothers and sisters. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us as parents to keep the right company, to sit in the company, in the majlis, in the suhbah of Ahlullah, of the people of the Quran, of the people of Islam, of the people who devote themselves to serve our religion. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless our teachers, our imams, our mashayikh. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our children from all challenges. Ameen. وَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا وَمَوْلَانَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَأَصْحَابِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ بِرَحْمَتِكَ يَا أَرْحَمَ